Good morning, and welcome to our service for Sunday the 25th of October 2020. I hope you enjoyed our short prayer walk last week, and I'll apologise for all the traffic noise. I must learn how to filter that out. That's another technical challenge for me to bite onto. But welcome to this week's service, and you'll find, as usual, on the website a link to a YouTube playlist which has some music on that you might find fits this morning's subject. So do feel free to go and follow that link and see what's what. Also on the website you'll see details of the readings for this morning if you want to read in a different version or if you just want to read them again. Excuse me, I've got a frog in my throat this morning. So let's come together in worship. And let's pray. Let's thank God for each other as we share in worship, as we come to pray and to praise. Let's thank God for the witness of Jesus and for the gift of the Holy Spirit to inspire and move us. And we bring ourselves to a moment of quiet, to a place of peace, to this place of safety and welcome. We bring ourselves to cast off the cares of the world and for a time to reflect on you, Lord God, so that our batteries may be recharged and our direction refocused and our energy renewed, that we might let go of things that hamper us and be free to care gently for those that we share time with. God, we pray that you will renew us so that we may renew others. And yet we come in humility and we ask that our confessions and griefs for what we have done wrong and for what we have left undone be taken from us. May our burdens be lifted and our inner souls released to share afresh the love that we have known in you. Holy Spirit of God, forgive us and assure us that our sins are forgiven, that our lives are renewed, and that we are loved and cherished and cared for. Amen. If you'd like to, please join me in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. So today we start in Matthew's Gospel, in Matthew chapter 22. And we start to read at verse 34. And if I put my glasses on, I can actually see what it says. There we go. So Matthew 22, beginning to read at verse 34. When the Pharisees heard how he had bested the Sadducees, they gathered their forces for an assault. One of their religious scholars spoke for them, posing a question they hoped would show him up. Teacher, which command in God's law is the most important? Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your passion and prayer and intelligence. This is the most important, the first on any list. But there is a second to set alongside it. Love others as well as you love yourself. These two commands are pegs. Everything in God's law and the prophets hangs from them. As the Pharisees were regrouping, Jesus caught them off balance with a question of his own. What do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he? They said, David's son. Jesus replied, well, if the Christ is David's son, how do you explain that David, under inspiration, named Christ his master? God said to my master, "Sit here at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool." Now, if David calls him master, how can he at the same time be his son? Excuse me. That stumped them, literalists that they were. Unwilling to risk losing face again in one of these public verbal exchanges, they quit asking questions for good. They were so desperate to denigrate Jesus, to prove that he wasn't who he was implying he was. And so they tried asking him hard questions, but Jesus, as ever, gives very wise, very challenging answers. I'm going to read now from Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians, from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, beginning to read at verse 1. Excuse me. Sorry. So, friends, it's obvious that our visit to you was no waste of time. We'd just been given rough treatment in Philippi, as you know, but that didn't slow us down. We were sure of ourselves in God and went right ahead and said our piece, presenting God's message to you, defiant of the opposition. God tested us thoroughly to make sure we were qualified to be trusted with this message. Be assured that when we speak to you, we're not after crowd approval, only God approval. Since we've been put through that battery of tests, you're guaranteed that both we and the message are free of error, mixed motives, or hidden agendas. We never used words to butter you up. No one knows that better than you. And God knows we never used words as a smokescreen to take advantage of you. Even though we had some standing as Christ's apostles, we never threw our weight around or tried to come across as important with you or with anyone else. We weren't aloof with you. We took you just as you were. We were never patronizing, never condescending, but we cared for you the way a mother cares for her children. We loved you dearly. Not content to just pass on the message, we wanted to give you our hearts. And we did. May God add his understanding to the reading of his word. Amen. It's interesting to note that in a fairly political divided landscape across the world, Jacinda Ardern won a landslide re-election in New Zealand. And while other leaders flounder and flannel elsewhere, what are the defining characteristics of her leadership? Well, she's been known to comment that in the quest to be seen as strong, leaders can lose the capacity for kindness and empathy. There's an interesting thought, that in the quest to be seen as strong, leaders can lose the capacity for kindness and empathy. Maybe that's something we need to hold in our thoughts. Because part of the problem is that we find it easy to compartmentalise our lives. Excuse me, this frog will not go away. To disconnect ourselves from other people and other communities, and that way we can shape our views into a kind of us and them situation. We can disconnect ourselves from the consequences of our actions by finding someone else to blame. And we can extend that disconnection to separate ourselves from the impact of our way of life on the poorest in our world and even on the natural world itself. And in this way, we can serve our own best interests by ignoring the interests of others and the planet on which we live. In our two readings this morning, we catch a glimpse of two people and their behaviours, which might give us cause to stop and think. First of all, the gospel reading. What sort of man is Jesus? Perhaps you might like to imagine yourself as one of the characters in that story, perhaps one of the disciples or a bystander close enough to hear the exchange between the lawyer and Jesus. What do you think about the way that Jesus responds to the question? After all, he must have been aware that the Pharisees were trying to trap him. And yet, it seems he was patient with them. His response is gentle and mild, explaining his understanding of the scriptures. And yet, at the same time, he's stating his beliefs and showing strength of mind and character in doing so. That steely strength needs to be added to the gentleness in order to be able to grasp the full picture of Jesus. And then we move to Paul's letter to the Thessalonians. St. Francis de Sales wrote that nothing is so strong as gentleness, and nothing so gentle as real strength. And the gentleness that Paul describes comes from strength. He'd undergone the life-changing experience on the Damascus Road, and after that he'd struggled to become accepted as a leader of the Christian community, which wasn't surprising when you consider his background and what he was doing before he met Jesus on that road to Damascus. He had to be strong. And yet, as a result of all that he endured, he knew that he himself was precious to God, and that gave him strength. And he showed that strength in gentleness to God's other precious children. And this is a dynamic that can be powerfully used in our own lives, in dealing with other people, especially when they express views that are different to ours. We need to be wise as serpents and gentle as doves. And this kind of approach flies in the face of current practice, where shouting folk down and hurling abuse passes for discussion these days. And it's hard to go against the grain. So what is religion all about? This is a question that those who are not committed to a faith often ask, or to which they give an inaccurate answer. It's easy to see observance of faith as being about rules and rituals, whereas in truth, it's actually about relationship. The Pharisees ask Jesus what's at the heart of their religion, and his answer is clear and unequivocal. It's about living in loving relationship with God and with your fellow humans. One wonders why it's still necessary to ask the question and how Jesus' answer can be more effectively conveyed to the world. Perhaps by the way we conduct our relationships, the way we live our lives, the way we behave. With strength, because we know we have Jesus with us in whatever we have to face. And with gentleness, because shouting and wagging fingers at folk and telling them they're sinners and need forgiveness is not the way to help them to know the Jesus that we know. We might be able to make people copy our behaviour, but we can't change their hearts. They have to do that themselves with the help of the Holy Spirit. So let me ask you a question. Do you love the church? Did Paul love the church? If we love God and we love one another, as we're exhorted to by Jesus himself in our gospel reading, we must surely love the church, the bride of Christ. So what might that mean? Well, Paul's letter to the Thessalonians gives us a few hints. And in the first couple of verses, we learn that those who love the church will suffer. And they'll suffer willingly. Paul and his associates have seen much success in Thessalonica. The people had turned from idols and trusted in Christ as Saviour. And we hear about that in the first chapter. Word was spreading throughout the region about what God was doing in their midst. However, the success in the Thessalonian church came at a great personal cost. to Paul. He and his associates have faced great opposition and physical harm. And just before their arrival at Thessalonica, Paul and Silas were seized and beaten and imprisoned. They endured great persecution because of their work for Christ. And Paul faced opposition and persecution throughout his entire ministry. But he had a heart for the church, and he willingly suffered for the sake of the gospel. We have the freedom to worship whenever and however we choose, as long as it's not in groups of more than six. We do not have to fear being arrested, beaten, or killed. But there are people all over the world who are suffering and dying for the cause of Christ. Why are they willing to suffer? Why do they put their families in danger? Why do they risk death? Well, they do so because they love the Lord and because they love his people. Countless souls have paid the ultimate price in their service of the Lord. As followers of Christ, we should love our Saviour. And if we truly love our Saviour, we will love his church. And if necessary, we should be willing to suffer for Christ and for his church. Paul could have lived a life free from all the pain and suffering that he faced, but he had a calling on his life and he was faithful to that calling. Paul loved Jesus. He loved the church. And furthermore, he loved lost people. And because of this, he shared the gospel with great enthusiasm, even in the face of opposition. The second thing we learn from that passage from Paul to the Thessalonians is that those who love the church will share the good news, the gospel, passionately. Paul preached the true gospel to these people. His heart's desire was to see lost people saved. His goal was to see unbelievers become part of the church. And this wasn't a bums on seats mission, because there was no physical church building to fill. They met in homes and open spaces wherever they could. The measure was not membership, but a change of heart. He and Silas were called and commissioned to go and share the good news of Jesus Christ. They were approved and entrusted by God to accomplish this task, and their ultimate desire was to please God, not man. Notice what Paul says in verse 4. He says, "We speak not as pleasing men, but God." It was a great responsibility and privilege for them to be sent out as ambassadors for God. We possess that same responsibility. The question is, do we see it as a privilege? Paul and Silas evangelized with great passion. One motive for their evangelism was the concern that they possessed for other people. And we should have that same concern for the lost people that we encounter on a daily basis. However we imagine it, there is an alternative to heaven, whether we call it hell or eternal damnation or just extinction. And we should therefore do all we can to warn the lost people of what is to come if they die without Christ. As Christians, we've been delivered from this threat to come. Many of our neighbours and loved ones are facing that future. As children of God, we should be sufficiently concerned and have sufficient compassion to evangelise, to tell the good news, the gospel, and to tell it passionately, based on our lives and our experience. And the third point in the latter half of that passage that we read is that those who love the church will labour enthusiastically. In those days, there were false teachers who would tickle the people's ears in order to get into their pockets, to make them successful and powerful. The Old Testament prophets had to battle against other prophets doing the same, declaring the message that the people wanted to hear, rather than the message God wanted them to hear. And this is an issue that remains prevalent even now. Some people pretend to be God-called preachers, but the reality is they're just trying to profit from the ministry. Paul didn't try to win the Thessalonians over by flattering them. He survived on what he earned with his own hands and what was provided by the Philippian believers. He wasn't there for the money. He was there because he loved the people. He was there because he had a heart for the church. He cared enough about them that he was willing to work among them. He worked among them physically and he worked among them spiritually. Paul was willing to do whatever was necessary to reach these people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We have ample opportunity to reach people for Christ. We encounter people on a daily basis who are in need, and that need is increasing. We should do all we can to help to meet those needs. When we lend a helping hand, people will be more apt to listen when we want to share the good news of Jesus Christ. We should be proud and honoured to be called men and women of God. Like Paul and Silas, we should love the Lord and we should love his church. Do you love the church? A final thought. The clocks here in the UK change this morning, and as the sun sets an hour earlier from this evening, we have longer and darker evenings. We're also facing tighter restrictions in the battle against COVID-19, on top of all the other challenges of this time of year. There's a lot to concern us. And as we reel from the adjustments to our lives once more, we need to be the ones who demonstrate that even though things seem so dark, we have a faithful God walking alongside us and sharing in our concern, our anxiety and our fear. And it's our responsibility as children of God, but it's also our privilege. Remember those famous words from Gilbert and Sullivan. Walk on with hope in your hearts, and you'll never walk alone. As a church community, we need to stand up and be a light for each other, but also for the community around us, reminding us and them to love one another, to treat each other with gentleness, and to work together for our bright hope for tomorrow to become a reality. Amen. So shall we come to God in prayer? Let's pray. We give thanks, Lord God, for the gentle, caring people in the world whose love of you radiates from their lives. We give thanks for their gentleness of voice and touch, for their smile, their listening ear, their quiet reassurance and understanding, their patience and perseverance with us. We thank you, Lord God, that you've touched the lives of these people and have enabled them to touch our lives and bring us to our faith and enrich our knowledge of you. We pray for those who have brought others to faith, who've shown them your love, who have tended to their needs and physical, emotional and spiritual. We pray for those who've put themselves in harm's way, for us and for others. We pray for those whose lives have been made harder because they've sought to serve you and help their fellow human beings. We pray for those whose selfless acts have caused them distress and fear. We pray for those who have, at any cost, shared the gospel of Christ. We pray for those imprisoned and tortured and killed for their faith and their witness. May they all be blessed in abundance with your love and your care. Amen. And so just before we close, I'd like you to thank you for being with us. I hope you found something in the message to give you pause for thought. And I hope also that you might find a desire to join us again next week. So from the security of this place, with friends and family and our faith community, be with us, eternal God, as we step back out into the world of mixed up all sorts of people. May we be kind and caring to all people, no matter how they treat us. May we be true to ourselves, hold our heads high, share your love and your care with all those that we encounter. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, today and in the days to come. Amen.